Can you hear me at the back? Yeah? Okay. So I just wrote some things on the board so that you'll have them here as I go along. So first is the website you can go to download the slides if you want to. just reminding of the notation here. So I'm using XI as the features, for example, I, and YI as the target, for example, I. We use capital X as a matrix that has the features, for example, I as the ith row, and then Y as the vector containing all of the target labels. We've been talking about the linear model where our prediction yi hat is given by w transpose xi. And we talked about least squares where you minimize the norm of x times w minus y squared. And then at the very end, we talked about cross-validation, where you take your data. Here I've just used it as x. And on fold one, if you're doing threefold cross-validation, you'll take two-thirds of your data, use that to train, use one-third, use that to validate. That gives you one estimate of the error. Now, on the next fold, you might grab these two-thirds to train and this one-third to validate, and you would fit a completely separate model, and that gives you a second estimate of your error. And then you would do this a third time to validate on the last part of the data. And that way, you can train on a little bit more data than if you just split it 50-50. Okay. So are there any comments on that before I get started? Yeah, that's a good question. So what do you do now? Because this just gives you an estimate of the error. And there's a few different answers on that. But the standard one is you might, if you're using this to choose the polynomial degree, now you've got the degree, and you might train on your full data set with the degree that you pick. So this might just be used to pick a parameter like the degree or the number of features or something like that. OK, any other comments before I start? Okay, so we know that if your model is too complicated, you can overfit. And we've said that this is bad. You can fit the training data well, but the test data not so well. But usually, the true mapping from xi to yi is complex. Usually, it's not just a linear model. Usually, you want something nonlinear, or you want something with a lot of features, or something like that. And so from what I've told you right now, it's not looking good. Because if you add lots of features, you're going to overfit. But you need lots of features. Sometimes the world is just complicated, and you need lots of features. So there's a few answers to that question. One of them, that's when you look at machine learning competitions, what the winning systems do is often they do model averaging. So to try and decrease the variance, to try and decrease overfitting, what they'll do is they'll fit many, many different models, but then they won't trust any of them. They'll actually average over many different models. And if the errors made by the different models are uncorrelated with each other, you can show that the averaging will actually reduce your overfitting. So you'll do better on the test set. That's not really an optimization issue, so I'm not going to go into that. I just want to mention that as the alternative approach. The approach that I am going to talk about is regularization, where we add some sort of penalty on the complexity of the model. And then this lets us handle overfitting in a more continuous way. So this is our standard least squares formulation that we spent the morning talking about. And the standard regularization is called Tikhonov regularization, or ridge regression, or whatever you want. You put a penalty on the L2 norm of the coefficients. So this is my standard formulation. And I had this one extra term with the scalar lambda, and I penalized the norm of W. So I don't want W to be too big. The regularization parameter lambda controls the strength of the regularization. So if lambda is very large, when you solve this minimization problem, you're going to want W to be very small. And we can think of that as having low complexity. If lambda is very small, then W can get very large, and then you have high complexity. And this is where you can lead to overfitting. And this has been reinvented many times in many different areas. I think the geostatistics people claim to have had the oldest reference to this, possibly predating Tikhonov, but I haven't seen that reference myself. So Tikhonov is the oldest one that I know of. Okay, so I don't know if I have this in this lecture, but if this is the first time you see it, this should look really weird. This is kind of a strange thing to do. What does the size of W have to do with overfitting? So if this is the first time you're seeing, it should be a weird thing. Even if this is the 1,000th time you see this, I still want to emphasize that this is kind of a strange thing to do. This is not how you would explain to your mom you should combat overfitting or something like that. This is a weird choice. Okay, so in terms of that fundamental trade-off, regularization is going to increase the training error. You're actually putting a penalty on the optimization problem for having big values of w. So if there's a value of w that can get really low training error, but w is big, then it's going to not choose to use that. So your training error is just going to go up when you add regularization. But the hope is that it makes training error a much better approximation of test error. So you're willing to have training error go up if it makes the training error approximate the test error better. And that's kind of the magic of regularization. The question of how should you choose lambda is very important. So in theory, if you want things like statistical consistency properties, you need n to grow as something like O of 1 or O of square root of n. Or 1 over square root of n. So you need lambda to kind of shrink over time in that case. In practice, you almost always use a validation set or cross-validation error. Or if you're doing something like feature selection, you can do things like BIC and AIC. But I'm not going to talk about those because I don't really like them. Almost always decreases the test error. So I'm going to list a bunch of other reasons you should do regularization, but from a machine learning perspective, the reason we do regularization is it almost always improves the performance metric that we care about. So I think I have a long list of like 7 more reasons to do regularization coming up, but first I guess we're going to talk about how to compute W. So that's our objective function. So I've used that the 2 norm is just W transpose W. I'm going to take the gradient, just like I did this morning. So the gradient of this thing is just going to be lambda w. And then this is still a quadratic function. So that's one of the main reasons to choose the 2 norm as the regularizer. So I set that to 0, and I get this thing. Or I can rewrite it in this form, where I'm using the lambda times w is the same as lambda times I times w. And then this thing, this matrix, you can show is always invertible. So I can pre-multiply by this quantity, and then I always get that it's this solution. So you have this nice form. Computationally, it has the same cost as the least square solution, or possibly a little bit cheaper, because this is actually going to be a positive definite matrix. So you can use Cholesky, which is a little bit faster than Gaussian elimination, but it's not more than a constant factor. If you want to do it in MATLAB, this is, again, one line of code. The cost is the same as least squares. At least it's this nd squared plus d cubed. And I would argue that you should always do that. You should never really fit least squares. You should always do this. And I think I have it on this slide. So Mark says you should always use regularization. Even if you think you have the true linear model, if there's any noise in the process, you should immediately start thinking of using regularization. So I've said the reason, well, I've given you this heuristic reason, it almost always improves test error. So anytime you have any sort of noise in your data or your target or whatever, you should expect to do better once you add regularization. But here are more reasons. The solution W is unique. So that matrix is positive definite, so that solution, that has a unique solution. You don't need X transpose X to be invertible. Your W is going to be less sensitive to changes in X and Y. So if x and y change a little bit, your w won't change as much. You can use Cholesky instead of LU factorization. When we start talking about large-scale methods for computing w, they actually run faster if you regularize. So you're making the optimization problem easier. There's something called Stein's paradox, where if you have a true w and your d is greater than or equal to 3, regularization actually moves you closer to the true w. So in the case where you really have a consistent model, there's a one W that's the absolute perfect W and you have your features right. If you have a dimension greater than 3, you're actually better off regularizing than not regularizing. And it's kind of a weird argument that starts working in 3 dimensions. And also, in the worst case, if you're choosing lambda by something like cross-validation, cross-validation can just choose lambda to be small, and then it sort of ignores the effect of regularization. So I would argue that you should always use regularization when you're doing things like least squares. Okay. All right, so are there any comments on regularization before I move on? We'll talk about regularization a lot more, and in particular, the L2 norm is not always the right choice, but it's a computationally convenient choice.
Is there any problem if I choose lambda too large, for example?
Yeah, so if lambda is too large, then your training error and test error are going to be almost the same, but your training error might be very high. So then it's no good, because you want the error to be low. Yeah, it's right here. So cross-validation is sort of my answer to everything. Is you want some approximation of how well this affects the test error, so you always go to cross-validation or validation set to choose things like that. It's an unsatisfying answer, but you can do a lot of theory to choose lambda, but in practice it ends up coming down to this. Okay, are there other comments? Yeah, definitely. So instead of doing that, I could instead of having lambda times norm of W squared, I could have lambda W transpose AW for some A. So the trick now is, okay, A has to be positive definite if I still want in the norm interpretation. The trick now is if I go to cross-validation and I'm trying to choose D squared parameters, now I can start overfitting by cross-validation. So if I'm just doing cross-validation to binary search for the scalar lambda, it's okay. It's not too bad. If I'm searching for an entire matrix, then I can really start to overfit. So maybe you want to restrict yourself to diagonal matrices or rank one matrices or something simple, and then you're okay. But the full matrix is often the D squared parameters by cross-validation, you run into some danger. Or maybe you have some prior knowledge. So another thing that comes up is if you have two different types of features, you might have one lambda for one type and another lambda for another type, and just choose those two lambdas by cross-validation. That's a very common thing. Okay, any more comments? Okay, so I want to talk about a different basis than polynomials. So polynomials are definitely not the only basis. So before lunch I mentioned that you could use like trigonometric functions, or you can use logarithms or exponentials. You can pretty much use any basis you can think of. I had a student come to me after the course was over, and she's like, there's probably only like five bases or something. And I was like, no, there's an infinite number of bases, and every new problem you're going to have to think about this problem. Okay, so we know that the right basis is going to improve performance a lot. But when you have a lot of features or a very complicated function, the right basis may not be obvious. And in those cases, it's important to make this distinction between parametric bases and non-parametric bases. So these things are called parametric bases. And what I mean by that is the size of the model does not depend on the number of training examples n. So if I'm looking at just degree 7 polynomials, then I have 8 parameters, with one feature anyways. Then I just have, and it doesn't matter how many training examples I have, I still just have those 8 parameters. So the more data I get, the better I can fit those 8 parameters. But at some point in time, I have so much data that those 8 parameters are not enough. So as n increases, you can estimate those parameters more accurately. But at some point in time, more data is not going to help because the model is too simple. You sort of reached like the limit of performance you can with those 8 parameters. The alternative to that is what's called a non-parametric basis. So here the size of the model grows with the number of training examples. So the more data you get, the more complicated the model becomes. And this lets you model very complicated functions where you don't know the right basis if you have lots and lots and lots of data. And so the example I like to give here is like sports. So I'm very, very biased by North American sports, but if you talk about like LeBron James or Steph Curry, when you're a little kid, you can try and bounce the ball and you're really terrible. But the more you do it, the more complicated things you can do. And now like Steph Curry can do like amazing, like ridiculous things that you would never think of because he's collected so much data that he's operating in like a more complicated parameter space. Okay, So one of the most common non-parametric bases is called radial basis functions. And these are bases that depend on distances to training points. And the reason they're non-parametric is because if you have more data points, then you have more distances to training points. And so the most common example is called the Gaussian or the squared exponential. So these functions just look like we're ignoring the normalizing constant, but a Gaussian distribution. So x1 is a training point. X is the particular point we're interested in, our input, and then we have some variant sigma squared. So training example, that's our parameter, the speed that it goes to zero. And then, so if we can contrast these, before we talked about linear bases, where you just have a line, or quadratic bases, where you've got a degree 2 polynomial with support everywhere, these things look like this. So if I'm at x, if I'm at xi, the thing will be large, and as I move away from xi, it's actually going to go to zero. It doesn't exactly hit zero, but if you're fairly far away, like 3 sigma away, it's almost close to zero. So you can almost think of these as basis functions that are only defined on a part of the space. So just around your training points. How you would actually use that is you make your X matrix, your basis matrix, as this n by n matrix. And it gives you, at least at training time, it gives you the distances, the pairwise distances between all n training examples. So there's n squared elements in this matrix. So this is the distance between x1 and x1. This is x1 and x2. This is x2 and x1, x1 and xn, and so on. So you make this n by n matrix containing distances to all the training points. So you can think of your yi hat as being w1 times this bump at x1, w2 times a bump at x2, up to wn times a bump at xn. You can show that these basis functions are universal approximators on any compact subset of Rd. So if your data lives in some restricted range and you keep putting down these basis functions in that range, you can approximate any continuous function. So arbitrarily complicated continuous function to arbitrary precision if you get enough data. So this will effectively solve the regression problem with tons of data. Someone in class asked where did sigma square root of 2 pi go, but in fact the normalization of the things is not important. So you can get rid of scalars in your basis. It's not a problem. So here I'm showing the RBF basis for different values of sigma. So here I think it starts from small sigma, then sigma gets, sigma started big, then it got smaller and it fit the data quite well, and then sigma got too small, and now your bumps are too far away from the data points, and now it's doing kind of weird things away from the data. So if sigma gets too small, this thing can overfit. With big sigma, it tends not to overfit. And in fact, as sigma goes to infinity, it actually turns into a linear model. Now it's going to default to, So here, it's going to zero away from the data. You could also add your bias variable, or you could add linear variables. So there's no, you don't have to choose the non-parametric or the parametric. You could have a parametric basis, and you add this non-parametric component to it to model more complex things as you get more data. So that's actually a very flexible model. And these things, I think, originally also came from geostatistics. If you do L2 regularization and RBF basis and use cross-validation to choose sigma and lambda, that's actually tends to be a very effective model. You can solve a lot of regression problems just with that simple formula if you have lots of data. So it gives you sort of maybe models that don't fit it well, maybe models that fit it really well, and models that overfit. But if you do cross-validation to choose these two parameters, it tends to give you a model that works reasonably well. Expensive at test time, though. So you need to measure the distance to all training examples at test time. So to actually classify a new example is a bit expensive with this basis. And there's a ton of research on sort of faster ways to do this. And these rely on interesting things like the n-body problem in physics and the fast Gauss transform and Kronecker products and whatever you want, torus structured matrices and all sorts of interesting things. I'm not going to go into them, but a lot of people really care about making these work at large scale. A related keyword, if you want to Google this, is Gaussian processes. So I think I have an example here of cross-validation just on lambda and sigma. So it's just going to explore a whole bunch of different values of lambda and sigma. So you can see sigma is here, lambda is there, and it's changing them, and it's just trying different possible things. And you're going to use cross-validation to pick one of those red lines. And the hope is that at least one of those red lines is going to be a good fit of the data. And you see there's actually a bunch of pretty good fits of this data, even though it's kind of a non-complicated nonlinear function, at least as far as 1D functions. And then, yeah, obviously when lambda is getting too small, we start to overfit and starts to do silly things. But there are some good models in there. The estimation of W or the estimation of F? So there are error estimates, and it depends on if you're estimating the parameters W or the function F. They're a little bit different, because there may be no true W in this case, but the F you can converge to. So there are some rate analyses where you look at how much data, how quickly do you converge to the true F. I don't know that literature too well, though, so I can't fully answer that question. Okay, next topic. So this was brought up this morning. Are there any more points on these non-parametric bases? They're a really cool trick if you're not too scared of the computational issue. In derivative-free optimization, there's a few things based on these. They're called what are they called? They come under various names. So there's Bayesian optimization. There's EGO. I think there's one called direct. So there's a bunch of optimization codes that are based on you evaluate your function at a bunch of points, and then you fit one of these RBF basis things to your function values to try and estimate where the minimum of your function is and where you should evaluate it next. And so those are kind of popular in the non-convex optimization world, where you want a method that really converges to the global optimum in some kind of reasonable amount of time. The convergence rates there are very weird, because if your function is not smooth, it's actually slower than grid search or randomly trying values. But if your function is sufficiently smooth, you can show that this will converge fast enough that you can solve your non-convex problem faster than the worst case rates would indicate. Okay, so this was mentioned this morning, is maybe you don't want to use the squared error. So squared error, we said, is computationally convenient, and it just involves solving this linear system. It's one line of MATLAB. But it's usually not the right choice. So one thing is it corresponds to assuming errors are normally distributed, but that's often not true. It's also very sensitive to outliers or just having data points with large errors. It might be inappropriate if you have restrictions. So if your y is binary, or if your y is censored, so if you're not allowed to see values above a certain value, you just know that this is there. It's at an extreme, then it doesn't really make sense. And there's tons of alternatives to squared errors, and these tend to have computational implications. In that, if we change anything, it's not going to be one line of MATLAB anymore. We're going to have to think about other issues. Okay, so let's first talk about the case of an outlier. So let's say you have your data like this, and on day 4, for some reason in your data set, it says 40,000. Completely ridiculous value. I'm assuming that this would kill you. It's probably just a data entry error. But this can happen. Real data is often messy. Real data, you often have mistakes or weird values. So this could be just error entering it. You could be contaminated from some other distribution. It could be a rare event. It could be that this is actually possible, but you just don't see it enough to make it worth worrying about. So as a picture, if we think in 1D, maybe we have a bunch of data points that are perfectly along a line, and then we have one data point that's completely unlike the others. Okay, so probably that's what you want to do. I'll talk a little bit later about what if you really care about this data point, but for right now, let's assume that this is just the student entered the data wrong. So we probably want this blue line, and if you fit least squares, it might give you something like that. It's kind of crazy, right? Like, why would it do that? It's really silly. So it's trying to make the error here smaller at the expense of making these errors bigger. And this has to do with actually the squaring. So squaring is going to shrink small errors, and it's going to magnify large errors. And that's going to make the outliers influence W much more than the other points. So if we just look at the absolute errors, if I just look at these vertical distances of every point, we've got a bunch of small errors corresponding to these points, and then we've got one huge error corresponding to this one. And what you want to minimize is the sum of these things. You want to make these as small as possible. But we're not working with the absolute error. We're working with the squared error. So we take all of these values and we square them. So the small ones, when you square them, they get even smaller. And the big one, when you square it, it gets to be enormous. So this line that we think fits the data really well, it actually has a very high error because you square this big value and you get an even larger value. Okay, so if we instead look at the absolute errors, if we look at this model that minimizes the least squares, it has quite high absolute errors because you're doing badly on all the data points. In contrast, the squared error is quite a bit smaller because you don't have the one big value. So the sums of the squares is actually smaller in this model, even though it kind of looks like a bad model. And now it depends on what you want. So if you really need to get the outliers right, if the outlier is the case where your plane is going out of control and you want to be good in that situation, then this is the right model. But if the outlier is because you've entered the data wrong, then this is the wrong model. And that leads us to robust regression. Actually, before I get there, is this point kind of clear? So we said that we squared things for sort of computational convenience, but now I'm arguing that squaring things is maybe not so good. Okay, so robust regression is we're just going to put less focus on the faraway points, and that's going to make us less sensitive to outliers. So the simplest example is you just use the absolute error. Instead of squaring it, we're going to look at the absolute value here. So now small errors and large errors, there's no difference. Everything is just error. Let's make the error as small as possible. That will actually give you this model here. So here, the absolute errors are quite small because you just add all these on top of this, whereas this model, the absolute errors are quite large because you add all those together and they get fairly large. So that's more robust. In matrix notation, we can write that as minimizing the L1 norm. So just as a reminder, the L1 norm is the sum of the absolute values. And so if we let our residual vectors be these elements R, that's the difference between our prediction and our label, then we're doing argmin of xw minus y, but we take the one norm instead of the two norm squared. Very easy to write down, and it does what we want. So that's the minimum of the two norm. This might be the minimum of the one norm, would actually be the model that we want. Now we run into a problem. Minimizing the absolute error is a bit harder. So the gradient doesn't always exist. If I look at the absolute value function, well, at zero, I'm non-differentiable. So I can't just take the gradient and set it to zero, because in fact, the gradient might not exist everywhere. There's no nice form anymore. One thing you can think of doing is you make a smooth approximation to this. So you take some function that looks kind of like the L1 norm, and maybe you just have a quadratic region here. And that was started in the 70s by a statistician named Huber. It's okay. It has sort of similar effects on test error, but it introduces a parameter. You have to know how to smooth it. And smoothing might actually make the problem harder. This is a very subtle point, is sometimes you can do these problem transformations where you think you're making your life easier, but some other transformation makes life harder. And we'll see a few cases of those this week. So generally, it's harder to minimize non-smooth functions. But in this case, it's not too bad, at least at medium scale, because we can write this as a linear program. So instead of solving a linear system, we're going to solve a linear program to solve this problem. And I just want to show you this trick, because it sort of shows up over and over again, and it motivates some of the models that we use. So we can write the absolute value as the maximum of smooth functions. Absolute value of W is the maximum of W and negative W. Kind of a weird way to write the absolute value, but you can convince yourself that this is a true equality. And we can convert functions with maxes into smooth minimizations with constraints. So the trick is, the first trick is we replace the maximum with a new variable that's constrained to upper bound the max function. And then we replace the individual constraints, or the individual constraint with a constraint for each element of the max. Very abstract, but easy to see if we have an example. So let's just talk about minimizing absolute value of W in 1D. Easy problem, the answer is zero. That's the minimum of the absolute value, but let's do this trick. Okay, so first we're gonna write this as a max problem. We take the max of W and negative W. Now we introduce a new variable, and I'm gonna call this R, kind of suggestedly. So I'm gonna minimize R, subject R being bigger than this max. So now I'm minimizing over W and R, and you can convince yourself that I haven't changed the location of the problem. So if R is gonna have to be equal to the absolute value at the solution, because otherwise you could just decrease R and still satisfy the constraint. So, all right, which is kind of what I just wrote. So a simple argument of that. And now the last step is, I don't really like having this max constraint, but I can replace the max constraint with just a constraint of each element of the max. So instead of having R bigger than the max, I'll have R being bigger than W as the first constraint, and R being bigger than negative W as the second constraint. So now I've got a linear function and linear constraints. This is a linear program. So if you have your standard linear program solver, you can just plug it in, and it'll tell you R is equal to zero and W is equal to zero in this case. But more broadly, you can solve general problems involving maximums. So let's do the same thing for the minimizing the L1 norm. We have our problem. We're gonna write it as a maximum. So we'll replace this absolute value with max of this and the negative of it. We introduce an R for each one of these maxes, so we have an RI. The RI is gonna bound this thing, and you can see that the RI is gonna bound the absolute residual. And then we split these into a set of different constraints, so we've got RI is bigger than the positive part, and RI is bigger than the negative part for all I, and now we're done. We've written this as a linear program, so you can just throw that into LinProg or Cplex or whatever, I don't remember what the new Cplex is called. It has some funny name. Okay, so this is a linear program. For medium-sized problems, if that nd squared plus d cubed is no problem, you can solve these problems too. In MATLAB, there's just one function, LinProg. There's other ways to write this as a linear program, but I'm not gonna go through them because this trick is gonna sort of be all we need for all the problems I'm gonna talk about today. Okay, so how does that look? I think this is maybe something that not everyone in the room has seen. But it's a nice trick. You can also go backwards, where sometimes you have a constrained problem and you want to turn it into an unconstrained problem and work with that. That's sometimes useful too. Any comments or questions? I'll walk slowly. Yeah, definitely. So it's very sparse. It has a beautiful structure. Because if you think about this, there's basically going to be like some identity matrices in there. And there's going to be your data matrix will be twice and then a couple identity matrices. But yeah, for large scale problems, this is not the right approach. So later in the week, we'll get to algorithms that will solve this at very large scale. But that's a great point. Other comments? Okay, let's go in the opposite direction. What if you really want to get the outliers right? What if you're worried about the biggest error you can make instead of worrying about the average error? So I want the best performance on the worst training example. So if in the worst case my plane crashes, I really want to protect against that. So in that case, maybe you want to go in the other direction. Instead of going from the 2 norm to the 1 norm, you can go to the infinity norm. So I want to do min of x minus y infinity. So I want to look at the biggest absolute value. So now I'm going to completely focus on the furthest away point. And I'm going to be very sensitive to outliers, but my worst case can be better. The other thing I should mention is, because we can write this as a max, that same trick I just showed is you're going to be able to use this to also turn this into a linear program. So this is also sort of same computational complexity as the L1. Okay, so as a picture, this was our data set with a nice line and the 1 point further away. Your absolute error is going to follow the main trend. Your squared error is going to chase the outlier. And then the maximum, if you do the infinity norm, it's going to really move away and try and move this away. So the distance to these points is roughly the same as the distance to these points. So you only really care about like two data points in this case with 1D. As you go to higher dimensions, you care about at least D plus 1 data points, I think. Okay, so we can also play other games. Why restrict ourselves to norms? So that we can think of this as the 2 norm. If my true value is yi and I'm predicting yi hat, well, I pay a penalty that grows as the square when I do least squares as you grow away. If I do the absolute value, it grows as the absolute value. So if I have a point that's really wrong, is way out here, it's going to be much smaller here, whereas the squared error could be huge. But maybe I want to be even more robust. Maybe I have outliers that are extremely far away, and I don't want to be sensitive to those. Well, I can think of doing something like taking the square root. I went from square to absolute value to square root. So that model is actually just going to give up on large errors. So if I have an error way out here, the square root model is going to be a little bit bigger, but you don't pay much of a penalty. This one is going to focus all its energy on getting things close to zero right, and very little energy on getting the far away points right. So it seems nice, but now we run into some serious computational issues. So this is actually an NP-hard problem to solve. So for those who are not from computer science, this means that we don't expect to have a algorithm that solves this large instances of this problem before the end of the universe type of thing. So, or put another way, if you can find an algorithm that solves large instances of this problem efficiently, you get $1 million. Literally. This is one of the millennium math problems, it's called. Is showing that you can solve these efficiently, if it's possible. We don't think it is. And so the absolute value is actually the most robust model that's not NP-hard. As soon as you go below 1, you become NP-hard. You become in this non-convex land. So that's kind of why we like the L1. Even though in principle there's better things out there, you run into some other issues. That being said, a lot of people do this in practice, because in practice it often still works well. So you only find a local minimum of it, but the local minimum you can often prove is quite good, or you can just try it out and it can be quite good. Okay, so summary of those few points. Validation and cross-validation, those are practical approximations to test error. Extremely widely used, they should be sort of part of any data analysis when you're worried about performance on new data. Regularization is what's going to allow complicated models or using lots of features, things like that, by penalizing the complexity of the model. We talked about radial basis functions, which are non-parametric bases, which will actually let you model any function if you have lots of data. Something that I didn't include, and I'm not sure is in the next slide, is the problem with the non-parametric methods is the number of data points you need grows exponentially in the dimensionality of the problem. So if you have a huge dimensional problem, then you need an exponentially larger data set in order to get that universal approximation. So they don't converge very quickly. These are still kind of used a lot. And one of the tricks people do is that they make fake data to try and fill out the space. So in Microsoft Kinect, your Xbox is staring at you and shooting a laser at you, and it sort of tries to draw a picture of where you are and say that like this is where your right elbow is type of thing. Now, in order to build a system, it's not based on RBFs, it's based on something called random forests. You need to collect data of like people in all different sorts of poses, people of all different sizes, people of all different races, people in all sorts of weird like angles and things like that. And so they collected a lot of data, but that still wasn't enough data to fit it well. And so what they did is they simulated fake people. They simulated people of different sizes and shapes, in different poses and all that, and then since they had the label, they could just make more data and they could fill up the space. And that's how you can use something very flexible to solve a very hard pattern recognition problem. And then we ended up with robust regression models, which are more suitable when you have outliers, and we're our first example where the squared error just isn't the right choice. And I showed you that neat trick of converting non-smooth problems into constrained smooth problems. So this was supposed to be the end of the day today, but we're a little bit ahead. So we're going to go into what I was planning to cover tomorrow, which is perfect. Okay, so are there any questions or comments on those issues before we get to an application and start talking about some large-scale issues? Do people like linear programming here? Have people heard of linear programming? Okay, that's good. You just apply it? We're not going to talk about how linear programming solvers work, because the generic linear programming solvers are not going to be fast enough for us. But we're going to talk about other methods. So LinProg is better than it was 10 years ago. So you should try out the more recent version, but I still don't actually use it. I use, what is it, GLPK or something like that is what I've been using.
Yeah, I have heard about it.
And then Cplex until my license expired, and then I didn't use that anymore. Okay, so some things we've talked about. Training versus testing. So supervised learning, we have the training set, X and Y, but we really care about this test error. Can we do well on new data? We said you always need assumptions to say anything about that, and so one of them is the IID assumption, that the training and test data come from the same distribution and that it's an exchangeable distribution, that the order doesn't matter. So often we have an explicit test set. So this is either given to us or we've made it ourselves. So we have X, Y, X test and Y test. So your typical workflow would be you fit the model based on X and Y, you predict Y hat on your test data, and then you evaluate your error based on your test data. And we mentioned this golden rule, which is that the test set cannot influence training in any way. Otherwise, this is not a validation of the approximation of the test error anymore. We mentioned this fundamental trade-off. It's how small you can make the training error versus how well the training error approximates the test error. We said that simple models have high training error but don't overfit, while complex models have low training error but they can overfit. But then we mentioned regularization is kind of like the cheat code, where you can reduce overfitting in complex models by regularization. So the most common approach is this L2 regularizer, and this is going to increase the training error but typically makes the training error a better approximation of test error, so it decreases the test error. Another thing to note is if you just increase the number of training examples n, if you just get more data, that has a similar effect to regularization, where you're probably going to have a higher training error because you've got more things you need to take into account, but you'll decrease the test error. That one's actually a little bit easier to analyze. Okay, so here's an interesting question. What is the best machine learning model? So I've mentioned a few things, the L1, the L2, whatever. You may have heard of these other things, SVMs, random forests, deep learning. When I get people from industry coming to my office, they often ask me this question. Okay, so there's something called the no free lunch theorem. So in short, there's no best model that achieves the best test error on every problem. So if anyone tells you that one machine learning method is the best, well, there's some other problem where it's not the best. So there, you can't actually be right. So this theorem says that if model A works better than model B on one data set, there's another data set where model B works better. So in some sense, all models are actually equivalent. It's a very negative, unsatisfying, disturbing result. And so asking what is the best machine learning model is like asking is rock, paper, or scissors the best move in rock, paper, scissors. It's not really a meaningful question. But there's a little caveat. In that the world is very structured, so some data sets are more likely than others. And what that means is, in practice, model A could really be better than model B on a whole bunch of applications. And that really is what happens in practice. There's no model that's the best in every case, but there are some models that just often work better than other models in many, many cases that you encounter in practice. So the no free lunch theorem is a little bit too pessimistic. And the field of machine learning really focuses on trying to find these models that are useful across applications. things like random forests and SVMs and deep learning, where they've not just been shown to be successful in one application, but they've been shown to be successful in many, many applications. And so when you come to a new application, you kind of expect them to be successful there, even though there is this negative result that your new application could be completely crazy and you could be completely misguided. Okay, we also talked about this idea of robust regression, where if you do the squared error, it can kind of do strange things, but the absolute error can be more meaningful. Okay, so that's sort of the overview of things we've covered. So the new thing is talking about important emails, and we're not going to say spam today, but you can replace important with spam in all cases. So we have a huge collection of emails, like in your Gmail, and we want to mark some email as important or not. And we're going to say, or at least in the Gmail, they say important if the user took some action based on them. So if this is an email you're going to reply to or forward to someone or whatever. So we'll say that's an important email. And we want a program that's going to identify important emails before the user has done anything. So they get put in this important email folder in your Gmail, and then theoretically those might be the only emails you need to read. I don't know if anyone actually does that, but you could. Okay. So this is more abstract now. We don't have X and Y. We have just a generic description of a task, and we're asking, can we formulate this problem as a supervised learning problem? And there's no sort of magic formula. I'm just going to show you one way to do it. But this is the approach that's ultimately used. Okay, so let's think of our training examples I as being individual emails. So YI is going to be a binary thing that says it's going to be +1 if the email is important. It's going to be -1 if the email is not important. So when we do supervised learning with discrete labels, we call it classification. So instead of regression, we're calling this classification. That's the easy part. That's sort of everybody could think to do that. But then the features is where everybody's going to disagree. What basis should we use for emails? How do we turn emails into vectors? Okay, so one thing you can think of is something called a bag of words. So I'm going to have a feature that's called Expedia. And this feature is going to be binary. The Expedia feature is going to be 1 if Expedia is in the email message, and it's going to be 0 otherwise. So that feature might tell you if something is important, where if you're booking a travel trip, then having Expedia in the email might be an indication this is important. If you're not someone who travels and it says Expedia in the email, it's probably an indication that it's not important. You could add things like, you're a winner. If you see this expression in the email, then maybe it's an indication that it's spam. Probably a pretty good indication. You can also think of doing things like regular expressions. So you can actually say, like, is my name in the email? If your name is not in the email, it's higher indication that it's spam. If your name is in the email, then it's probably not spam. Or if your sender comes from like mail.com or something like that, then maybe it's more likely to be spam, whereas if it's coming from IMPA, then it's maybe not likely to be spam, so it should go into the important folder. So we're not saying that any of these are strict rules, but we're going to try and fit a model that's going to let us accurately predict these +1s and -1s based on these features. May not work every time, but it's going to work enough of the time that you can actually put these into production. And in fact, all of the email spam filtering and all of the importance email things, these are all based on supervised learning type of approaches now. So it's sort of completely replaced the earlier rule-based methods. So as a picture, our X matrix is now a binary thing. And you've got things like the Expedia column, which is 0 if I don't have Expedia and 1 if I do have Expedia in here. And then my regression target is these +1s and -1s, which are saying whether they were spam or not. So this email here just had Expedia in it and it didn't have my name in it, so it was a -1. This one had Expedia, but it also had my name, so that was a +1. That was actually an important email. So it was directly targeted at you. But let's think of making this even more fancy. Because if I'm Google, I don't want to train a supervised learning model for every single user. If I'm thinking I want to have 100 million users, I don't want to have 100 million models. I want one model that's going to kind of work for everybody. So I want to make this a bit personalized. And the way to think about this is you have some sort of universally important issues where you have something like, if the email is, this is your mother, something terrible happened, call me as soon as possible, that email is going to be important no matter who you are. And there's nobody who's not going to do something if they get that email. But other messages might be more important to one user than to others. So in the Expedia case, if you're someone who travels a lot, that could be an important email. If you're someone who doesn't travel, that may not be very important. So this is what I call the big global local feature table. So our y's are plus ones and minus ones across all users now. And the first set of columns, this is the global features. These are features like Expedia and so on that we're going to measure for every single user. And every user is going to share these. Then the next set of columns, that's going to be local features for user one. So these are features are where it's like it says one if this was an email to user one and it said Expedia. It's one if this was an email to user one and it says you're a winner. If it says you're a winner and it's emailed to user two, then you set it to zero. So if we imagine just all the emails to user one being here, then you'll have all your ones here, and the emails to other users, this will all be zero. So it's an extremely sparse matrix. So you've got here the zeros and ones for everybody, and this is just for user one, just the words that appear in things to user one. And the reason we want to do that is now I'm going to have some special regression weights that are for everybody. I'll have some special regression weights that only affect user one. And so that way I can do different things for user one than for each other user. And now I add the local features for user two. So maybe they'll be all non-zeros will be there, and so on. So does that kind of make sense? We're sort of, if we think of the regression model, I probably have it written on the next slide. Maybe not. Is our regression model, we're going to be yi hat is going to be w global transpose x global. So these are you know all the words and phrases and things like that times some weights that are shared by everybody. But then we have w local times x local. So we've got some extra part, and this is trying to learn specifically about you and specifically about your taste. So how does Expedia specifically affect you in a different way than it would affect the average user? Okay, so if we have a new user, it's really nice. Because if you have a new user, you don't know anything about them. But you can still use the global features to predict what's important to a generic user. So if someone logs into Gmail for the first time and they get that email from their mom, it says this is important, even though it knows nothing about you, because it has this WG, and that's shared by everybody.
What we're saying is that Gmail learns from it that matrix local matrix, WL. Is that right?
It learns WL for you, and it learns WG from everybody, including you. And so WG can predict on a new user, even though you don't know what WL is yet. So those are the ones that are shared across. But as it starts collecting more data on you, you can update the global features a little bit, but you also update the local features. And that's what's going to make the predictions personalized. You have this extra part here. I guess I've used U instead of L here. But that's things that are specific to you. And so now it can learn specific things about you that's going to be different than the global model. The actual system is a classification method called logistic regression, which is a model that I will talk about a lot. And it's probably on the next slide. So are there any more comments or points about that before we get into what logistic regression is? And logistic regression is used everywhere. You've probably been affected by several logistic regression-based products today. Huge. Huge, right? So I mean, this, you know, it's big not only this way, D is very big, but N is very big too, right? This is every email. So we're not going to do X transpose X on this data set. We need more fancy things, but it is possible. Okay, other comments? Okay, so classification using regression. Sounds kind of weird. So our usual approach is to do binary classification with regression is we say y is plus one for one class and minus one for the other class. So for now, right now, let's just assume there's only two classes, so spam and not spam. So we've effectively taken this discrete thing, we've embedded it in Euclidean space by having these two special plus one and minus one values. Now you fit your linear regression model. So I'm going to say fi hat, because it's not really yi anymore, but we take our linear combination of features as we did before, w transpose xi, where you could have something more fancy like this. And then to classify, you want to know if you're closer to plus one or minus one, so you're going to take the sign of w transpose xi. So if w transpose xi is greater than zero, it's closer to plus one. If it's less than zero, it's closer to the minus one. So that's how you decide whether you're going to predict if this is a plus one or minus one. It's the absolute first thing you would think of if you only know about regression and you want to do classification, and it works pretty well. There's a little bit of a problem with the squared error, but that idea of turning classification into regression is very, very wildly successful. Okay, so as a picture, here's my xi, I've got my yi here, and I'm going to have special values, minus one and plus one here. And let's imagine this is our data set. And so xi, as we have more and more of this email, so let's imagine this is your name, maybe. It's maybe negative two or something like that. So imagine xi, something, if you have a lot of it, oh, I see, not important. So maybe imagine this is like Vicodin. So this is a drug that's sold illegally online a lot. So it's in lots of spam messages. So maybe if you have like a very few of these, it could be an important email, but as you get more, it's more likely to be spam. So if you have many of these features that it's large, then you have minus one. If you have a smaller number, it's plus one. And the way the classification using regression works is I'm gonna fit a linear regression model to this data as before, so my least squares fit might be something like this. So it's still trying to get the line as close to the x's as possible, but the x's are just lined up in a row now, which is a bit weird. And then you make your decision, which is a little bit hard to see. I guess we can't really dim the lights or make the projector brighter.
Yeah, when you turn it off, right,
do I have control over that?
No, it's bad.
This here is the point where W transpose XI is equal to zero. So where we cross there. And if you're on one side of it, you classify as minus one. If you're on the other side, you classify as plus one. So it's where the regression line crosses zero. That's when you flip your decision. So it's a little bit of a weird geometric interpretation, but this is kind of how we turn classification into a regression problem. And now it's nice, because everything I talked about earlier about regression, we can now apply. We can start talking about, maybe you want to do a polynomial, maybe you want to do regularization.
Is that better?
I don't know if that makes a big difference. You can do cross-validation to select your features or to select the regularization parameter, to estimate your test error and so on. So this is nice. So all the stuff I've said before still applies to this new class of problems. You can do all your tricks, but there's a weird thing that happens when you do this. So let's think about this. So we've explicitly got Vicodin, and we've got not spam and spam. So if you have very few, then it's not likely to be spam, whereas if you have Vicodin happening like 100 times, it's definitely spam. So this seems like a nice data set. We should just do least squares, and we can go home. You would hope for something like that. This is a perfect classifier. If I have it go down here, then if you're on that side, I say it's plus one. If you're on this side, it's positive, and I'll say it's minus one. Or rather, the sign of the thing is negative. So that's my classification boundary. And that's great. Except, that's what least squares does. So if I didn't tell you it was a classification problem and told you to fit least squares, this is probably roughly the line you would draw. And this is not good because of these data points. So the place where it flips the decision, it's fit the data okay. Linear model is not even terrible here, but what we cared about is the sign of the regression function. We care about where it flips zero. So the ones over here, these are correctly classified. They're on that side of zero. These ones are correctly classified, but these ones are now incorrectly classified. So even though there was a linear model, this green line, that actually perfectly classifies the data, when you just do least squares, or even L1 in this case, this is a different issue, it will actually misclassify some points because it's trying to minimize the squared error instead of trying to get those points right. Do people see why this is the problem? I'm gonna show you a picture, but maybe let's think about why that's gonna happen. So I call these good errors and bad errors. It's very hard to see, but this says these errors here. These are the good errors. So here you're getting penalized for having the wrong class. So we definitely want to penalize those points. These errors here, I'm calling these the bad errors. So here, even though you've made the right decision, you're actually getting a quite large error for having that there. So we call this the bad error because it's actually penalizing you for having the right answer. So in regression, you were just trying to hit a very specific spot. But now we're trying to hit an orthant. We just want this thing to be positive. But we're saying if you're too positive, that's a bad thing, even though in principle you don't care because you're making the same decision. That's just a plus one. So the problem comes when you take this perfect classifier, your regression line goes way down here, and then so the error on this point, which you've classified perfectly, is enormous. So least squares doesn't like having this big error. So it's got a huge bad error, and that's why it wants to do this orange line instead of the green line. So logistic regression is normally motivated from a different perspective, but I thought we would take this geometric interpretation of why you use a different model. Okay, so some people like this figure, and some people don't like this figure. So maybe I will pause on this, because this is something that is not easy to get the first time you see it. But it's kind of important for understanding why we're going to introduce some more ugly-looking regression functions. Questions from over there? No? Yeah, it's really hard to see. Hold on. So there's an orange line here. Which is what least squares is actually doing, but it's not what we want it to do. We want it to be along this green line here. So this line is quite bad. I'll increase fonts for tomorrow, I guess. Okay, so the way to think about this is in terms of loss functions. So let's say the target label is -1 here. If we did our squared error, well, you get zero error if you're right at -1, if that's your prediction. And as you move away from there, it starts to go up. Or if you start to go in the other direction, it starts to go up. So I'm predicting right here, the error I'm going to get is up there somewhere. So this is the good error region. So my true label is -1, and I'm predicting a +1. I'm predicting a positive value, so this is good. I want you to be penalized for predicting the wrong sign. But right here, this is the bad errors. This is where the true label is -1, and I'm predicting like -3. And that's okay. It still has the sign right for doing classification. So predicting -3 is fine. But it's saying predicting -3 is just as bad as predicting 2 over here. And it's not. So you can do L1, which looks like this, but L1 is not going to solve the problem, because L1 is still doing the same thing. You get penalized a lot for predicting -3, even though predicting -3 is good. So what you really want is something called the 0-1 loss. So this is something that's 0 if you're negative, and it's 1 if you're positive. Also known as the number of errors you make. you get a penalty of 1 every time you make an error. You get a penalty of 0 every time you don't make an error. So that's a natural thing. Let's find the linear classifier that minimizes the training error. And that's a weird problem. So the 0-1 loss function, just minimizing the number of errors. Well, if a perfect classifier exists, you can write that as a linear program and you can solve it. No problem. There's even older algorithms. There's something called the perceptron algorithm from the 50s, which will also solve this. And it only involves vector-vector operations. So it's extremely scalable. You can prove that it makes a finite number of errors and then just gives you a solution to the problem. Otherwise, if the number of errors is not 0, this is actually an NP-hard problem. So we don't expect to be able to have an algorithm that will find the linear classifier that minimizes the number of errors. So it's a little bit frustrating in that, you know, if you had a beautiful data set, it's an easy problem. As soon as your data set has a little bit of noise, which it almost always does, we're into NP-hard territory. So it's a little bit, it's like data-dependent NP-hardness. So usually you don't use the 0-1 loss. You use some sort of approximation to the 0-1 loss. And the two most common ones are the hinge loss and the logistic loss. So the hinge loss leads to something called support vector machines, and the logistic loss leads to something called logistic regression. They look very similar to each other, but they're both, the motivation is to address this bad errors issue. So just to show what that looks like, this was our 0-1 loss, the thing that we want to count the number of errors. And the hinge loss looks like this. So if I want to predict -1, and I start predicting positive things, you start to pay a linear function. But if you predict -2 or -3 or something like that, you just get 0 error. Now, the reason this is nice is this is going to be a convex function. And that's going to actually let us solve this quite efficiently. So even though it's kind of weird that you pay a lot of penalty for having something really wrong as opposed to having something a little bit wrong, and then there's also this issue here where you still get penalized a little bit for getting things right, but at least it goes to 0 here. And the logistic loss looks almost exactly the same, this green line. And the main advantage of the logistic loss is it's differentiable. It's actually a Lipschitz continuous function. Well, they're both Lipschitz continuous, but it also has a Lipschitz continuous gradient, which is very nice for optimization methods. So those are sort of the two standard approximations. There are many others you can think of where if you have like imbalanced classes, you might want to do something different for +1 than for -1. But these are the two most common approaches. And the logistic loss is the one used by Gmail. So the hinge loss, mathematically writing out this blue line, is going to be the max of 0 and 1 minus yi w transpose xi. It's not really too important, the form of that. I'll just note that it can be written as a linear program. And if there is a perfect classifier, it will actually find one. So that linear program will still solve the NP-hard problem in the cases where it's easy. And if you add an L2 regularizer to that, as you always should, then this is what's called a support vector machine. And these were enormously popular machine learning models in the 90s and the early 2000s. But now they've fallen out of favor a little bit. But they're still very widely used in practice. Because this is a quadratic function, it will be a quadratic program instead of a linear program. But you can write it as a quadratic program using the same max trick we talked about before. Now you need lambda to be small enough to get a perfect classifier if one exists. And there's also this interpretation in terms of margin maximization. So if you've done Coursera, if you've seen another a machine learning course, they usually motivate this from a completely different angle. But we're just using geometry because it lets you see this nice connection between the logistic loss and the hinge loss. OK, so the logistic loss is something that looks like this. Log of 1 plus x of yi w transpose xi. So that is this green function here. The exact form of it is not too important, but the main advantage over the hinge loss is it's differentiable. Yeah, plus regularization, of course. So you've got that global local feature, you've got the regularization, and then they have a special algorithm to handle the large-scale data sets, and I'll get to those later in the week, the type of algorithms that let you solve huge problems. Okay. can't be written as a linear or quadratic program anymore. You've got transcendental functions, so it's a little bit, it seems a little bit uglier, but it's actually differentiable and has a lot of very nice properties. So I'm going to start talking about how to solve these problems next time. It turns out this is an optimization problem. We can solve very large instances of very quickly. And there have been a lot of advances, even in the last 2 or 3 years. Okay, so just pause to mention that these two models are kind of used everywhere. I don't care which one of you, them you use. They work very similar to each other, so I'm not going to spend too much time on the differences. But just, you know, you can often interchange them. But these are used for all sorts of things, like predicting like which ads you're going to see on the web page, email filtering out your spam, all sorts of other neat things. Reasons why they're used everywhere. So training and testing are both very fast, even for large-scale problems. So even training on all the emails, you can fit these models reasonably well. Easy to understand what the weights mean, the WJ. So my fiance, when she did her master's, they were fitting like logistic regression models in like health sciences to figure out like what is the effect of different factors on health and things like that. So these are used by less technical people too. With high-dimensional features and regularization, you often get good test error. So it often works well. And if that doesn't work, you can still try the RBF basis and regularization, and that will often give you good performance too if you have lots of data. Another reason people like logistic regression and to sometimes prefer logistic regression is it has a probabilistic interpretation. So if I make a model where I say the probability of yi being plus 1 given w and xi is given by this thing called the sigmoid function, which is 1 over 1 plus exp of negative z, something that looks like this, then minimizing the logistic loss corresponds to a maximum likelihood estimate. So if I have a particular probabilistic model, this corresponds to maximum likelihood, which is fine on its own, but the advantage at test time is it can actually give you probabilities. Instead of just predicting plus 1, minus 1, it says, well, this email, there's a 0.9 probability of being plus 1, and this email, there's a 0.6 probability of being plus 1, and maybe I want to treat those two cases differently. And so that's a little advantage to the logistic loss, is you have the probabilities at the end of the day. But I'm not going to talk about probabilities too much, because that will take us a bit off course. So why is probabilistic interpretation important? Well, you can get this 99% versus 51%. And for more complicated yi, I'll mention you can start from probabilities and derive losses. But more importantly, you can start talking about maximizing expected utility. So let's say I predict spam and that the true label is not spam. So I've put the wrong thing in the spam folder. That's a different error than if I predict not spam and it really is a spam. Those things have different costs. So if you keep putting the emails that are not spam in the spam folder, then your users are going to get really annoyed. Whereas occasionally, if you put a spam thing in the not spam folder, well, they can just click spam and then move on with their life. But you don't want the user to have to constantly look at the spam folder to see if there's a good email in there. When you have these probabilities, you can actually you can put costs associated with these two operations, and then you can talk about maximizing the utility. So if I have the probability of something being spam and the cost of being spam given that it is spam versus the probability of it being not spam and the cost when it's not spam, I can actually decide where my threshold should be. So if there's a 51% probability that something is spam, I probably don't want to put it in the spam folder. I probably only want to put it in the spam folder when it's at like 70% probability or something like that. And so that's why having probabilities as an output can be very helpful. Okay, so I'll short pause here before I move on, just in case there's any comments at this point in time or questions or anything like that. Oh, so they perform very similarly. So I don't really recommend one or the other, unless you need these probabilities. So a lot of people try and take the SVM outputs and turn them into probabilities, so that's something else you can do. But logistic, you're directly estimating the probabilities, so that's kind of nice. Yeah, SVMs became very popular because they combined this notion of regularization also with nonlinear bases and sort of put it all together in nice software packages. But now there's nice software packages for logistic regression, and it turns out they work very similarly. So the distinction was not as important as it was emphasized maybe 10 or 15 years ago. So if I just wanted to minimize the probability of making a mistake, I would just threshold at 50%. Where it's like, if it's greater than 50, I'm saying it's a spam. If it's less than 50, I'm saying it's not spam. Here I'm taking into account that if making one mistake is different cost than making a different mistake. That if I'm if there's a big cost for predicting plus one when it's really minus one, and there's only a small cost for predicting minus one when it's plus one, then I want to take that into account. Then I want my probability to be higher, or I might want my probability to be lower depending on the cost. So this is just saying that you don't necessarily want to minimize the number of errors. You might have an extra cost, and you want to minimize that. Yeah, that's a great question. So I'm not going to talk about that approach, but that's very common. Is you just turn it into, if you have, let's say, C classes, you turn it into C classification problems, where in each one you're predicting that class versus all the others. And then you have to somehow combine the results of these C classifiers. I'm going to mention a little bit more elegant way to do it, but that's a very common approach in practice. The more advanced approaches is you train a classifier to distinguish every pair. So you train C-squared classifiers and try and combine those results. And then there was a clever idea of this is like a problem in coding theory. So we can start looking at different sorts of information theoretic codes and try and fit different classifiers that distinguish things and then try to combine those to correct errors in the individual classifiers. Those have become less popular over time. It's now switched to the one that I'm going to mention shortly. Okay, so just very brief, throwing out some words here more than anything. So if I'm doing unregularized logistic regression, this corresponds to a maximum likelihood solution where you're maximizing likelihood of data given the parameters. So the well-known problem with maximum likelihood is the data could be very likely in some very unlikely model from your family. So maximum likelihood could really memorize the data. So when you do regularization, it corresponds to what's called a MAP estimate, a maximum a posteriori. And there you're maximizing the probability of the weight vector W given the data. And with just some basic rules, you can turn that into this problem, where here you've got your loss function, like your squared error or your logistic loss, and this would be your regularizer here, the log of your prior. So there you treat the model as a random variable and you find the most likely model. And this, when you have this interpretation, you can view the regularizer as taking into account that complex models are likely to overfit. You want a prior that encourages simpler models. I'm not going to go into that as much as I normally would because we're going to get into more optimization-y stuff, but that's an important side note. Okay, so the multi-class logistic regression is if I have my xi, but my yi now is in a set of classes k. So instead of being plus 1 and minus 1, we go 1, 2, 3, 4, and k. So the example is we used to have just itchy and scratchy being minus 1 and plus 1, but now we've got the new character, Poochie. Okay. We're almost done. Okay, so now instead of just being plus 1 and minus 1, we've got 1, 2, and 3. And the class 3 makes everything much harder. So the standard model in this case is I'm going to have a weight vector WC for each class C. So instead of having one weight vector that's going to go between plus 1 and minus 1, I have a W for each possible class. And what I'm going to want to do is I want to make WC transpose XI big when C is the true label YI. Then at test time, what I do is I set YI hat to be the argmax over C of WC transpose XI. So that would be useful to write down. Unless I've got it on the next slide. Oh, I do have it on the next slide. Okay, so we're imagining, okay, let's just pause there. So that's our decision variable. I'll mention that if your classes are ordered, if like class 4 is closer to class 3 than it is to class 2, there's other models you can use. So this kind of assumes that it's unordered. And if you have things like count data, so if you want to predict like the number of Facebook likes you're going to get or something like that, then you wouldn't use this because you want to treat 71 likes as being very similar to 72 likes as opposed to being a completely separate class. But this is the most common thing. So just showing what that looks like. Now instead of having a vector W, I have a matrix W, and each column is going to be the weights for one of my classes. So I'll have k classes. Each of them have d because you have one weight for each feature. And to make a prediction, I'm going to compute this matrix W transpose XI. It'll compute the inner products of XI with each of the W's. And to do this, we want some loss function that's going to make this value big when C is the true label and otherwise makes WC transpose XI small. And the way to do that is with something called the softmax function. So I want the true one to be big and the other ones to be small. And one of the first things you think of doing is because W transpose X can be positive or negative, is I'll find some transformation that makes it always positive so that I can compare these in a nice way. And so the common approach is you take the exponential. So I've motivated that as one of the first things you would try to do. You can prove that this choice has a whole bunch of nice properties. It relates to things like exponential families and maximum entropy and so on that we're not really going to talk about in this course. But this choice does have beautiful properties. So we make it, our probability is proportional to exponential of the thing we want divided by the sum over all possible things. So it ends up being a true probability distribution. And so if k is equal to 3, then we have, or if we have 3 classes, then we have the correct one here and all the other ones here. And this actually is a generalization of the sigmoid probability that led to the logistic loss. So if you just have 2 classes and you set one of the weights to 0, you get the sigmoid function as a special case. And I think that is where I'll end. So that ends up with a loss function like this. It looks really nasty. It ends up being a convex function that has beautiful properties that we'll be able to exploit starting tomorrow. So to end off today, just course roadmap. So part one is kind of today, which was an overview of machine learning. So we didn't really get into the technical content. I just sort of gave you a bunch of motivating applications. And then we started talking about basic ideas like basis, regularization, loss function. Particularly those who are not used to the language I'm using, I'm hoping this will set up the context to understand what's coming. We talked about the basics of learning theory, training versus testing. I didn't talk about bias variance, but I did talk about the fundamental trade-off and no free lunch, and then a little bit about this maximum likelihood and loss functions. So what's coming up is large-scale machine learning. So tomorrow we're going to talk about why are logistics and SVMs easy. Well, minimizing the number of errors is hard, or why can I minimize the L1 norm but not the square root value? And we're going to start talking about how do we fit these models to huge data sets? What if I can't afford to do D squared or even N times D or something like that? What if I want to train on every email on Gmail? What do I do? And that's really going to be the focus of the rest of the week. Okay, so I'm going to end there.